also, you know, another thing on that album, you know, again, Ain't No Mountain High Enough was, that was number one from that album. So when that went number one, what was your and Nick's kind of perception at that point? Because obviously it came out a couple years prior, so.
Well, that was a concerted effort to give Diana a song where her speaking voice could be utilized.
Right.
Because she had a very sexy speaking voice. And also they had, you know, the records that we were making up to that time were like 3.5 minutes long.
Sure.
And we wanted to do something longer. I think Isaac Hayes was doing long records.
Yeah.
So that was our go at that kind of thing.
Yeah.
And so we had this long dramatic buildup and all of this, you know, we're
not going to
say, and we're not going to say the title till way down. So when Barry heard that, he was like, oh no, this is taking too long. Yeah. You know, you got to, y'all got to step it up, take the back and put it on the front, you know?
Right.
But he said, or else I can't release it. Mm. And we thought about it.
Yeah.
We had worked so hard on that production, and we thought it sounded so good.
Oh,
that
it did.
We could, and even though he was a fine songwriter, and usually it was something that we could do, we would get something from his comments and be able to utilize. But this time we just said, no.
You did it on your
own. We'll take our chances and just let it go on the album.
Yeah. And if anyone knows the difference between both songs, I mean, that Diana Ross version is... it's sultry, it's soulful, it's slowed
it's
down.
It's two different versions all the time.
Two completely different. Yeah. It's almost like the remix, you know what I mean? What, before the remix, you know what I mean? So, unbelievable.
Call my name.
you know, moving right along here, 1969, it was 1969, Reach Out and Touch Somebody's Hand. You know, I want to talk or have you talk about that album. And this song in particular is just such a wonderful song. Mm. What do you remember about being in the studio with Diana at that time and producing and writing that record?
Well, that was an important step for us because Diana was leaving the Supremes, and this was going to be her first solo album. Mm-hmm. And usually albums were shared by producers. You do three songs, you do three, and we'll have an album. But Barry said, no, I want Ashford and Simpson to have the whole album. Mm-hmm. So that was a big step, you know, a vote of confidence, of faith in us, you know, because she was the doll of the company. Make no mistake about it.
Yeah.
So to be able to frame what it was she was going to say at that point, stepping away from the girls, you know, meant a lot to us. So we, you know, we worked hard on it. And Reach Out and Touch, you know, I'm proud because of the longevity and the legs that it has.
And the message, what,
the
too.
Message, of course.
What a great message.
You know, from the church to community events, anything, you know, still sung. I make more money now on that than, you know, than when it was a hit initially.
Sure.
So, you know, it meant a lot that we have that kind of song. Mm-hmm. And it actually was born out of me playing an organ in the studio.
Oh, really?
And it had that little churchy feeling. And then Nick came up with that line. Yeah. And then we finished the song.